Moroccan King Mohammed in Ghana on a three-day state visit.
Newly constituted Hajj Board inaugurated by President Akufo-Addo.
Live on GBC24 and GTV, it's time for News Hour. Good evening and you're welcome. My name is Seyoko Kwakuchre.
I am Shirley Annan.
The President, Nana Akufo-Addo, says Ghana will support the fight against terrorism around the world.
At an interaction with members of the diplomatic corps at the presidency, President Akufo-Addo said Ghana will strengthen alliances with missions to advance the nation's development.
It is an annual custom for the diplomatic corps to deliver goodwill messages from their respective governments and institutions to the president. They also deliberate on the global situation and plan ahead. This year, as Ghana turned 60, members met the new government. For President Akufo-Addo, it was a moment to once again meet familiar faces, many of whom he interacted with when he was Ghana's foreign policy chief in the previous NPP administration. Foreign Minister Ms. Shirley Ayokobuchi encouraged all to support Ghana to strengthen her relations with the rest of the world. The Dean of the Diplomatic Corps, Madame Pavlin Tendai Musaka, pledged their commitment to help in this regard.
In welcoming the new government's commitments, the diplomatic community looks forward to the government's articulation of national development plans over the next few months and stands ready to align its support to emerging national priorities on agricultural transformation to drive jobs and growth, private sector development, good governance, and domestic resource mobilization in line with Ghana's needs and expectations as a middle-income country.
President Akufo-Addo said, among other things, his focus will be to improve on education to build Ghana's human resource base.
A government is not going to shy away from taking the critical decisions that are necessary for the long-term interest of our people. We are going to invest heavily in building up the most important ingredient of development, the intellectual property of the people, the mind, education, our sure key to success. We want to add value to our human capital, add value to our governance, add value to our public services, and add value to our infrastructure, and add value to our economy. We will govern honestly. We are determined to get Ghana once again, to have Ghana lead once again our continent on two fronts, in entrenching democracy and the rule of law, and in transforming the structure of the African economy to a modern manufacturing kind that has the capacity to generate jobs for our people and create and spread wealth across the length and breadth of our vast continent.
President Akufo-Addo was worried that the growth of democracy on the continent is being stifled by terrorism.
I wish to assure you that all the alliances and friendships that we have entered into over the last 60 years are going to be developed and maintained during my time as President of the Republic. We are determined to leverage these alliances and friendships to grow our economy and nation. Ghana stands firmly with all civilized nations in repudiating terrorism as an instrument of political action, commits itself to doing everything within its means to support regional, continental, and global efforts to defeat this 21st century scourge. Ghana is equally committed to the reforms of the global political order.
The president said Ghana will support the effort to defeat terrorism.
The King of Morocco, King Mohammed VI, is in the country for a three-day state visit. His visit is expected to deepen bilateral relations between the two countries. The king will hold talks with President Akufo-Addo, meet with the business community and Moroccan residents in Ghana.
The Moroccan king was met on arrival by the Vice President Dr. Mahamadou Bawumia, Foreign Minister Shelly Ayokobotri, and other high-ranking officials. Morocco has a rich culture blending those of the Berbers, Arabs, Africans, and Europeans. The North African country was accepted into the African Union at the 28th ordinary session in Ethiopia after it broke ranks with its predecessor organization, the Organization of African Unity. Ghana and Morocco share a common ground when it comes to global politics. The two countries gained independence around the same period, 1957. Besides, Ghana and Morocco played pioneering roles in the formation of the Organization of African Unity, which has now metamorphosed into the African Union. Morocco occupies a high pedestal in telecommunication, tourism, fisheries, and banking. The Moroccan leader, King Mohammed, took over the mantle after the demise of his father, King Hassan, in 1999. He is expected to leave the country on Saturday, February 18th.
The President Nana Akufo-Addo has sworn in the newly constituted Hajj Board, chaired by veteran politician Sheikh Isikwe. The 11-member board is to immediately oversee the organization of the Hajj pilgrimage to the Holy Land in August 2017. President Akufo-Addo charged them to organize a Hajj-free Hajj.
The National Hajj Board operates under the office of the President and works with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and the Saudi Ministry of Hajj Affairs to organize the pilgrimages. The President has the mandate to appoint the chairman and its members in consultation with the National Chief Imam. The new 11-member board is chaired by Sheikh Isikwe, with Mr. Abdul Malik Adams Garba, Mr. Farouk Hamza, Sheikh Amin Bonsu, Al-Haji Inusa Amadu, Mr. Kamal Din Abdullahi as members. The other members include Mr. Ismaila Ibrahim, Mr. Mahamadou Osmanu Alidu, Mr. Mohamed Osmanu Yunusa, Mr. Brahima Adams, and Dr. Mohamed Ibrahim Mohamed. Its first duty is to prepare for the next Hajj pilgrimage, which comes off in August 2017. In all, about 25,000 Muslims across the country are expected to make this trip. For some time now, the Hajj pilgrimage has encountered problems including accommodation, flights, feeding, ticketing, among others. But the charge from President Akufo-Addo to the new Hajj board is to organize a problem-free Hajj this year. Sheikh Isikwe, the chair of the newly constituted board, promised a peaceful Hajj pilgrimage.
On behalf of the members of the board and on my own behalf, I promise to uphold you, to hold your good name, and to cooperate with all Muslims so that pilgrims will go to perform the Hajj with ease and comfort.
We have already prepared the ground. His Excellency, we're going to prepare the ground, and the ground is fertile, inshallah. And then we promise and hope that this year Hajj will be a Hajj of difference. Inshallah.
The National Chief Imam, Sheikh Nuhu Sharbutu, urged the new board members to work diligently and with commitment.
You have promised Almighty Allah. You have promised Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You have promised the President of Ghana that you are going to work so hard to ensure that this year's Hajj is going to be free of any challenges.
President Nana Akufo-Addo said quality work should be their watchword.
I'm anticipating that with the caliber of people that have been assembled on the board this year, under the leadership of a well-known public figure, a man who has distinguished himself in the service of our country, the problems associated with the annual pilgrimage will be things of the past, that we will see a smooth, seamless movement of people to and from Mecca as a regular occurrence. That is why I've come here this morning to perform this ceremony.
Ahead of the pilgrimage in the second week of August 2017, the board says work starts now.
The Vice President Al-Haji Dr. Mahamadou Bawumia on Thursday morning inspected progress of work on the $14 million National Mosque at the Kaukudi Junction in Accra. When complete, the over 7,000 capacity place of worship will serve as the country's national mosque. Dr. Baumia was satisfied with work done so far and pledged the government's support to see to its scheduled completion. The project began 3 years ago.
The Ghana National Mosque complex is 33 meters high with a diameter of 19 meters. It is a prototype of the Blue Mosque in Turkey. The ultra-modern mosque has three entrances and four minarets extending up to 62 meters with two balconies. Dubbed the Accra Falcon, it is a gift from Turkey to the people of Ghana. Many say it has the potential to be one of the most beautiful buildings in the city. The over 7,000 capacity mosque will house a school, health facility and residence for the National Chief Imam. Rear Admiral Tahiru is the head of the technical committee of the project.
Just as we entered in the early stage of its construction, this is the administrative block for the school. And this here will be the library. The library would handle researches up to doctorate. The aim is that the library should be available for any research that anybody has to do on anything that is Islamic. The universities will be able to assess it and all that. That will be the library.
The Vice President Alhaji Muhammadu Baumia assured the Chief Imam of government support for the project.
We are 80% complete now, and hopefully by the middle of the year, the rest of the work would be done. So I'm most pleased with the progress of the work, and we look forward to its completion this year, inshallah, and we will take it from there.
The contractors say the mosque is expected to be completed by 6th of March and inaugurated for worship on the same day to commemorate Ghana's 60th birthday. And the entire building is expected to be completed in May, the month of Ramadan.
Election of regional representatives to the Council of State has ended across the country. At the close of the exercise, 9 out of the 10 regions elected their representatives to the Council of State. The election in the Upper East region was delayed because of a legal tussle. In all, 113 candidates stood in the elections. We'll bring you how the Greater Accra Region election was conducted and the winner.
The election to choose the Greater Accra representative to the Council of State was held at the Gan West District Assembly Hall at Amasaman. Polls opened at 10 o'clock in the morning and lasted about 20 minutes after all 32 members of the Electoral College had cast their ballot. With 20 votes, Nkorte Zani, CEO of Ideal Financial Holdings, beat all 13 contenders to emerge the winner. 16 people were initially contesting the elections, but 3 stepped down before voting started this morning. The 3 are Mr. E.T. Mensa, Mr. Eric Asameni, and Nenete Kwesi Achemai.
And we have some of the elected regional representatives to the Council of State. Northern Region Professor Nantoma, a retired civil servant. Volta Region Francis Albert Nyonyo, a businessman. Central Region Nana Pia Nyama, Paramount Chief Chifo Mampon. And Ashanti Region Nana Usu Echao, Chief of Akronfosu. We update you with a full list with time. Meanwhile, the elections
committee of the Ghana Journalist Association has announced the date for nomination of candidates for this year's elections. The positions to be contested for are president, vice president, general secretary, organizing secretary, treasurer, public affairs officer, as well as regional executives. A statement signed by the chairman of the committee, Mr. Ben Asoru, said nominations begin today, Thursday, 16 February 2017, till Monday, 27th February 2017. Voting will take place on Friday, March 31st, 2017, from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. at designated polling stations, to be announced later. The filing fees for the position of president is 1,000 Ghana cedis, vice president and general secretary, 800 Ghana cedis, 500 Ghana cedis for organizing secretary, treasurer and public affairs officer. Filing fees for regional chairpersons will be 500 Ghana cedis, while other regional branch positions will attract a 300 Ghana cedi fee. Nomination forms can be obtained from the GJA website, www.gjaghana.org, and payments should be made to the GJA's National Investment Bank account at OSU. Completed forms and receipts covering payment of appropriate filing fees should be submitted to the GJA Elections Committee on or before Tuesday, 7th March 2017.
The MP for Tamale North constituency, Alhassan Soini Saiba, has urged government to ensure that funds that will be allocated for the Ghana at 60 celebrations are applied for the intended purpose and properly accounted for.
The engagement of land guards by people to protect landed properties has been a source of worry for most Ghanaians. On the floor of Parliament on Thursday, the MP for Gomwa East, Mr. Kojo Asemenyi, said the activities of land guards in some parts of Accra, which started in the mid-90s, have gradually become a curse than a blessing.
These so-called land guards added personal interest and involved the use of harmful objects, knives, cutlasses, and even guns in the attempt to seize people's properties. In the process, they deprive others of even properties they had legally or genuinely acquired. It is in line with this that I'm calling upon this Honorable House to, as a matter of urgency, begin investigation into the activities of these groups.
Members from both sides called for a stop to the activities of land guards.
Mr. Speaker, I recall with a lot of pain how a police officer by name Kweku Ninja was brutally, and another were brutally murdered at Ablekuma in the late 90s. Mr. Speaker, even though the security agencies at the time were able to apprehend a handful of land guards for perpetrating that heinous act, the menace posed by land guards is still an issue that needs to be tackled head on.
The fact that there are the land guards, if we, the citizens of this country, land owners, don't patronize their activities, they wouldn't have anything to do.
Do we register land today? Just by the press of the button, you bought land from the owner, you go with your certificate or with receipt to the land title registry and get your land registered. No. For all this money from the World Bank has spent is spent on land administration project, are we getting the benefit of it? Our institutions are not working.
On March 6th this year, Ghana will be 60 years and President Akufo-Addo plans to raise 20 million Ghana cedis for the celebrations.
Let the celebration not be used as an opportunity to dissipate public funds and reward political party loyalists. Let our actions not always be about how many ballots are counted in our favor, but by how much hope we give our citizens, how many reasons we give them to smile, and the daily solutions we offer to them.
The MP for Tamale North constituency, Alhassan Soini Saiba, was happy for this decision by the president, but cautioned against misappropriation of state funds during the preparations. The House adjourned sitting to Friday, 17th February 2017.
Vetting of nominees for regional ministerial positions is over. On Thursday, nominees from the Northern, Central and Bunafa regions outlined their plans for solving peculiar problems affecting their respective regions.
Duncan is the minister designate for the Central region. The nominee suggested three ways by which he intends to deal with poverty in the region.
The way to go is to get large investment in there, but that notwithstanding, there is a CEDICOM, Central Regional Development Commission, that is in there to do promotion and facilitation of small and medium scale developments. As regional minister, if I'm privileged to have your nod, I'm going to get them to do even more. There's a need also for them to advertise, to tell people that these are the things that you can find if you decided to come to the region. So, Mr. Chairman, if your venerable committee gives me the nod, I'm going to open my eyes more and work with the Central Regional Development Commission to ensure that the facilitation, the promotion that they need to do, they're able to do it.
The Minister Designate for the Northern Region, Mr. Salifu Said, said he will not meddle in any chieftaincy dispute but work to close the ranks of factions in the conflict-prone region.
Taking advantage of the Bagri Dam spillage for irrigation purposes. But I believe the nominee, having traveled across the whole three northern regions, knows that any time the spilling is done, the currency with which the water flows destroy property and sometimes even lives.
We will be able to turn that perennial disaster to an opportunity, because if we are able to develop canals, we get experts to develop irrigation canals, dams. In fact, it will fit very well into His Excellency Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo One Village, One Dam concept, so that some of the communities that this water runs through and it floods their farms. Consciously, experts, Irrigation Development Authority will be engaged to look at it, even if they don't have the expertise in Ghana here. There are some other countries that they are doing very well in irrigation development work. They can come and look at it, and then we'll be able to develop things that will trap the water, and it can be used for the dry season, vegetable production and other things.
The minister designate for the Bunahafu region is Mr. Kweku Asumatreme.
My vision for the region is to make sure that there is optimum security for all and sundry, is to make sure that job opportunities are made available, going by the MPP's manifesto, One Factory, One District. When this is done, we'll have the opportunity of getting more jobs for the teeming youth in the region. And it will also curb the migration from our rural setups to the cities. For instance, in Accra will not be choked. And we also make sure that the activities of the illegal miners, popularly called Galamsey, is put to a halt. Bunahafu is notably known as food basket. Reasonable steps will be taken to make sure that our farmers are given proper incentives and inputs.
Ghanaian in the Bunahafu region has created a wooden helicopter which is drawing everyone's attention in town. The manufacturer is 32-year-old Elvis Opon with basic level education. Our Bunahafu regional correspondent Frida Aban caught up with him in the Doma East district of the region.
You may call it road helicopter. It doesn't fly, but moves on the road. It has a passenger capacity of 4. Some of the town people joined the vehicle on a recent road show. The brain behind it is 32-year-old Elvis Opon, who hails from Wamina 4 in the Doma East district of the Bunahafu region. He says he is a caterpillar operator who lost his job about 2 years ago. During the last election campaign, the then First Lady, Mrs. Lordina Mahama, came to their village on a helicopter. After watching the vehicle for some time, he felt inspired to construct one himself.
I use wood to build a helicopter.
and used metal to line the underpart. I used the engine of a tricycle to make it move.
Elvis says if he gets support from the government, he will travel the length and breadth of the country to promote innovation among the youth.
You're still live on GBC24 and GTV watching news. We're taking a short break. Please don't go away.
Good evening and many thanks for joining us. It's time for business and I am Dorothy Ajimai. President Akufo-Addo says he will create a petroleum chemical industry in Ghana and link the various natural resources to make Ghana an economic powerhouse in West Africa. Nana Akufo-Addo said this is part of plans for his transformation structure of Ghana's economy.
We plan on introducing programs that will boost the productivity of our agricultural sector and introduce incentives that will encourage our banks to provide affordable credit and other financial services to our small and medium-scale enterprises and launch a new wave of viable industries across Ghana. This is summed up in our slogans of one district, one factory, and one village, one dam. Our oil and gas deposits in the Jubilee, Tern, and Sankofa fields offer us the perfect opportunity to create petrochemical industries, including monetizing our gas to create a multi-billion dollar gas feedstock industry. We have the opportunity to link together our numerous natural resources like food produce, bauxite, iron ore, oil and gas with our talents, energy, and sense of enterprise to turn our nation into an economic powerhouse in Africa, generating employment and income for our youth.
The Ghana Revenue Authority Special Revenue Mobilization Task Force has retrieved an amount of 50.1 million Ghana cedis from newly registered businesses between August 2015 and December 2016. These monies were retrieved from 801 companies in a bid to sustain the gains made. The Special Revenue Mobilization Task Force has indicated that it will intensify the tax compliance checks this year.
Since its establishment in August 2015, the Special Revenue Mobilization Task Force undertakes programs and activities geared towards maximizing tax revenue to achieve the revenue target. Between January 1, 2016 to December 31, 2016, the task force, in collaboration with the tax offices, collected tax revenue amounting to 183.6 million Ghana cedis compared to 138.8 million Ghana cedis in 2015. This, according to the coordinator of the team, Mr. Henry Sam, throws a positive deviation of a percentage of 32.22%.
The above collection performance, we have the details here by tax type and then by regions. We're done, like I said, not only by the task force, but with full support of the task offices nationwide. The task force has 8 monitoring teams, and each monitoring team is supposed to collaborate with the task offices to conduct tax compliance checks and to rake in tax revenue.
With an objective to strengthen the tax collection machinery by ensuring full compliance of non-compliant sectors, letters have been written to MDAs, MMDAs, and other private organizations to furnish the team with transactions made. The task force team says poor record keeping, non-submission of tax returns by some registered taxpayers, and falsification of tax clearance certificates are some of the few observations and findings.
The above irregularities did not only constitute infractions of the tax laws and regulations, but also tax evasion. Hence, the tax compliance test to block revenue leakages to maximize tax revenue.
Publication of names of offenders, imposition of penalties and interest, seal off, and taking distress action are some of the few mentioned sanctions for non-compliance. GRA says in 2017, the task force will compile data on registered businesses in collaboration with some institutions in the country to unearth defaulters.
The Statistical Service will this year rebase the national economy. This exercise, according to the acting government statistician, Mr. Bawadie, was conducted 5 years ago, which he describes as a static base. The rebasing is to take account of current figures, expand market, and facilitate supervision.
Rebase from time to time to take account of changes that we anticipate, particularly in certain indicators that we use for computing the figures, that, such as the inflation rates, such as the consumer price index and inflation rates, such as the GDP. And we intend to replace the current series of the consumer price index. The current series has a base year of 2012, and we intend rebasing to 2017. The general theory is that after 5 years, most static bases start losing their effects in terms of accurate reportage, so that we take up account of current changes in the expenditure patterns or consumption patterns of households. We had the last Ghana Living Standards Survey Round 6, which reported largely on the expenditure of households, and we want to use that to actually adjust our weights, so that our weights reflect more current expenditure patterns of households. We rebase it to take account of certain new approaches that we want to introduce. We want to, one, introduce the use of code books in the collection of price data from the markets. The code book stem from the fact that we want to record the specific outlets for specific.
You're watching the business segment of the news. Moving on, the Minister for Lands and Natural Resources, John Peter Amewu, has tasked the Lands Commission to reduce the turnaround time for land title registration to 30 days. Registering a land at the moment takes 3 to 6 months. This, according to the minister, is a disincentive to investment.
Too distant past, it took close to 2 years or more to register a land at the Lands Commission. With reforms and digitization of the process, the Commission has been able to slash registration to an ideal period of 90 days. But Minister for Lands and Natural Resources, John Peter Amewu, believes the process is too long and not attractive to investors.
Fortunately, we have spelled it out clear in our manifesto that we need to minimize this duration to at least 30 days. Yes, if vaccines for increasing in salaries, computers, good working environment. And this is also a maxim. And that's where the contract begins.
While accepting a task described by the Commission as daunting yet attainable, the Executive Secretary of the Lands Commission, Dr. Wilfred Enim Odami, called on the minister to address a number of challenges, chief among them staff attrition. The Commission is also calling on the minister to ensure that 100% of the internally generated funds are retained. The Minister for Lands and Natural Resources is on a familiarization tour of institutions under his ministry. The visit is expected to give him first-hand information on the challenges, progress, and opportunities of staff therein.
Into bank markets, the pound is selling at 5 cedis 44 pesos, the US dollar at 4 cedis 37 pesos, and the euro is also trading at 4 cedis 62 pesos. commodities market, light crude is trading at $53.14 per barrel, cocoa at $2,099 per ton. Gold is also going for $1,237.60 an ounce. For business, we bring you the health segment after this break. Please do stay.
And now to some health news. The College of Health Sciences of the University of Ghana and the Ghana Health Service will soon build a clinic for scrub dealers at the Agbogbloshie Market in Accra. The facility will attend to the health needs of scrub dealers and other people who operate in the area.
Scrap Metal Site in Accra is Ghana's largest center for electronic waste, recycling and disposal. Workers manually disassemble parts and bend the plastic cases on computer wires and refrigerator coils to recover profitable metals, copper among others. The work is often done by young adults using handmade tools and without protective equipment. Medical professionals say the practice leaves them in danger of catching respiratory infections. Overexposure to lead could prove fatal. The black smoke emitting from the fires pose additional health hazard. To keep the fires burning, old car tires are also added to the flames, creating a toxic environment. To ascertain the level of air pollution and toxic substances that emanate from burning of scraps and their implications, the University of Ghana College of Health and Sciences, in partnership with the German Development Agency, has launched a project to build a health center within the area where the scrap dealers operate.
So we want to assess the quality of air here and also to take blood and urine from these workers and assess whether by their work any of these substances have ended up in their bodies.
The scrap dealers were given a backpack to wear for 8 hours. The backpack is expected to trap the particles of toxins in the air.
The bag that they are carrying is for environmental assessment. So it has several equipment in it. It's going to monitor the things that are released from the electronic waste, okay? It's going to measure temperature, carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, which come out when they do the burning. You see, they burn a lot. You have seen it, these black plumes of smoke. It releases a lot of toxic substances into the environment. So we want to actually analyze what is in this smoke and how it will impact on human health.
The Greater Accra Regional Director of the Ghana Health Service, Dr. Linda Vanotu, lauded the project and urged the dealers to cooperate with the health personnel and to ensure their safety when the clinic is built. The Ministry of Youth and Sports also donated an abandoned warehouse, which will be converted into a clinic. The construction of the clinic is expected to start in May this year.
More stories in this package. Please stay with us.
Thank you for staying on. The government of the Democratic Republic of Congo says it will not be able to afford an agreed presidential election this year. Budget Minister Pierre Kangudia said the cost of organizing the poll, which is said to be $1.8 billion, is too expensive.
Last year, the government and the opposition agreed that new elections would be held at the end of 2017. President Joseph Kabila's final mandate ran out in November 2016. Mr. Kabila's opponents have accused him of repeatedly delaying the poll in order to remain in power. The plan to hold an election before the end of 2017 initially reduced tension between the government and the opposition. The Electoral Commission said last November that it needed at least until July 2017 to register more than 30 million voters in the country.
Two more suspects have been arrested in connection with the death of Kim Jong-nam, the brother of North Korean leader Kim Jong-un, in Malaysia. A female Indonesian suspect and a Malaysian man both detained. A woman traveling on a Vietnamese passport has also been detained.
Kim died on Monday after apparently being poisoned while waiting to board a flight in Kuala Lumpur. Police say they have now finished their post-mortem examination, though the results have not yet been made public. The two female suspects have been remanded in custody for 7 days. She was identified from airport CCTV footage and had an Indonesian passport. Malaysian Deputy Prime Minister Ahmed Zahid Hamidi formally confirmed on Thursday that the dead man, who was traveling under the name Kim Cho, was Kim Jong-nam. There is widespread speculation that North Korea was behind the killing, but there has been no proof. North Korea is on Thursday celebrating what would have been the 75th birthday of Kim Jong-il, the late leader and father of both Kim Jong-nam and Kim Jong-un. Kim Jong-un was seen attending a ruling party meeting on Wednesday. Footage aired on state media showed him grim-faced and did not wave when he left, as customary.
A 64-year-old woman has successfully given birth to healthy twins, a baby boy and a girl. In northern Spain, a hospital delivered the twins by cesarean section, the usual method in such rare cases.
The unnamed woman had undergone fertility treatment in the United States, according to a Spanish media report. In 2012, the woman gave birth to a girl who was later taken into care by social services amid welfare concerns. Social workers said the girl was being brought up isolated, poorly clothed, and with bad personal hygiene. No decision has been taken yet about the mother's twins. They and the mother are reported to be in good health in hospital. The boy weighs 2.4 kilograms and the girl 2.2 kilograms. The delivery went without complications. In April 2016, an Indian woman in her 70s, Dalin Jakua, gave birth to a healthy boy in India's Haryana state after fertility treatment.
And that's all in the international front. Coming up, we have sports.
So the BBC fight on the 11th of March this year at the new Bukom Boxing Arena. The bout Christian Freedom Fight Night is to celebrate the country's independence anniversary.
As part of activities to mark Ghana's 60th independence anniversary, Streetwise Boxing Promotions and General Hawks Sports Management and the Ghana R60 Planning Committee will on Saturday, 11th March, host three World Boxing Council WBC title bout at the Bukom Boxing Arena in Accra. Three world titles are up for grabs under the bill Freedom Fight Night. Three Ghanaian world title prospects, Richard Comey, Duke Micah and Frederick Lawson, will face crack European and North American challenges. Launching the event, the chairman of the Ghana R60 Media and Branding Subcommittee, Jefferson Saki, said boxing has won laurels for Ghana, thus its place in national sport cannot be downplayed.
At the end of this celebration, which is a year-long celebration, we have to ensure that the newness of Ghana that we're all looking for, the oneness in Ghana that we're all looking for, we should be able to achieve that by the end of 2017 when we complete our 60th independence anniversary celebrations.
Two of the boxers, Richard Comey and Duke Micah, promised not to disappoint.
This title fight is going to be my first in 2017 and I'm going to win this title. Right after that, I'm going to win and win and win until I bring the world title to this country.
I'm the new champion in Ghana, and I'm coming to make Ghana proud, you know, because I refuse to lose. I'll be a winner because that is what I do. That's my job.
The promoter of the bout is Mr. Michael Amubediakon.
We have three fantastic young fighters in Richard Comey, in Frederick Lawson, and in Duke Micah. All world-ranked fighters that we can look up to and know that in the future they will be world champions. But we have to give them that platform. And that platform starts on March the 11th.
The Freedom Fights Night has five additional undercard bouts, which will involve boxers such as Emmanuel Enim, Papu Aluti, and Felix Ajom featuring.
The launch of the first blind football league in Ghana is taking place in Accra. The initiative by the Dan Devan Disability Foundation is to inspire visually impaired persons in the country who have football at heart to hone their skills and earn a decent living. We do apologize for the breaking sound there. That's all for sports.
Hello, good evening. Time for some art news. My name is Valerie Danso. The Overflow Experience, a fully packed Christian entertainment event, has taken place in Accra. It was a combination of a gospel music show, a stand-up comedy, and a film premiere under one roof. Here are highlights.
Stage were performances by Joe Metal, Ni Eni, Preachers, Worship in Motion, and Inner Circle Choir. The event also saw the premiere of the film One Last Look. In the movie, the lives of two married couples turn sour and they are plunged into the muddy waters at the verge of a divorce.
None of us is living until we trust each other.
Look,
we
have come.
There was also a special comedy session from the king of Christian comedy, Akpororo.
My name is called Akoro. I made you want to laugh for a living. If I crack joke, you don't laugh, that means your problem is bigger than my gift. I can't keep myself from you. You get problem, I get problem. All of us like it. All of us like it.
The Overflow Experience has come to stay and will be an annual event of Christian arts and entertainment.
That's all in this segment. Have a good evening.
it for the weather update. Good evening. See you tomorrow.
That's a wrap of the news for now. Thank you so much for watching.
News tonight is at 10 p.m. Please make a date with us.
Good evening.